It starts right now.
Okay. Dad brought me my coffee.
How does this start? Isn't that sweet? Well, after he was like nutty during the show, our station manager.
Can we explain why?
Pat,
where did he go?
Well, let's welcome everybody to Outnumbered Overtime. OT baby, so they know what they're watching. Yeah, so Patch, Joshua Patch, is our stage manager. And what did he do?
So I, due to a snafu with childcare, had to bring my four-year-old to work with me today.
He's precious.
Thank you. Thank you. And he was sitting off the set. And
he did such a great job.
Thank you. Yeah, he was wonderful. Thank you.
What did Patch do to him?
Patch, God only knows what Patch was. You know what? I was busy with the show. Don't even want to know what Patch was doing to him. But then I merely leaned over to wave to this poor little child who maybe was missing his mother, and Patch goes ballistic, starts snapping his fingers, yelling at us to start focusing on the show. Completely.
I think I started talking about Hillary Clinton's closet aide.
Yeah. By the way, Patch meanwhile threatening that he was going to show him guns and ammo websites while I was on air. Like, the whole thing. This poor kid is going to walk out of here like, you know.
Guns, ammo, and bourbon.
Guns, ammo, and
Patch.
Bourbon, and Donald Trump. So, you know, it's like.
But good on you. You made it work.
That was hilarious, the way we all started to laugh at the same time at something.
Oh, I couldn't even read the prompter.
I couldn't see him, but I could see Melissa's reaction. And he was snapping like, you know, there was a beat going on. And Melissa's eyes, which are already so beautiful and big, were like this. And I look up and I'm like, what the heck is happening over there?
Somebody was attacking us or something. Like, look over your shoulder. There's someone coming through the window.
Oh,
we're a little vulnerable in there.
Anyway, all of our people watching right now who are signed on to the live chat, and I want to get to some of the topics. The Clinton Global Initiative has more tentacles than a jellyfish. Spikester Zero. Mm.
You're going to see a lot of that when all this stuff comes out. Is it being timed for the campaign? Absolutely it is. Is it being written by people that do not wish her in the White House? Yes. Mm. Are they serious lawyers and accountants? Yes. And this stuff is going to start to drip out. Some of these people have shared some of these things with me.
Yeah. Oh.
The Clinton Global Initiative's reach was extraordinary. And much of it was without the proper governmental authorizations at the time.
But may I suggest something that, and again, putting the partisanship hat aside. If you think the Clintons are corrupt, they're not your cup of tea. You're not voting for her. You've thought that for 30 years. So this is not your cup of tea. If I were Donald Trump, this is not what I would be talking about. Let the press talk about it. We're all talking about it, not just us. But I mean, the mainstream media is talking about it nonstop. He needs to focus on things that real people actually care about, which is the economy, which is national security, all the issues, whatever is polling.
I think he's been doing a lot of that, though.
I agree with you.
Really?
Stop fighting. Yeah. I don't.
If the issue
is... the big immigration speech.
If the issue
in the
economy.
That's not what I mean. Yeah.
If the issue in the campaign is does Donald Trump have the temperament, intellect, and bearing to be president?
He loses. Of course.
If the issue in the campaign is, do we want a third term of Barack Obama in the form of Hillary Clinton? He can win.
But that's not what he's talking about.
Well, that's why I say I agree with you. You should be talking about those things.
The news keeps getting in the way. I mean, when you have a situation like Orlando, when you have a situation like what's happened so many times with terrorism overseas, you've got a presidential candidate willing to go down to a place where people are calling him all sorts of names south of the border. Not that he hasn't thrown some names himself throughout the primary season here and there. But, I mean, when you have somebody who is willing to kind of step into the fray with the people of color that he's angered in the past.
Right.
I mean, he just, here's the fold. It's got daggers in it, and he's going in there barefoot. I mean,
do you think the Mexico thing played well for him?
You know,
I thought he blew it back in Arizona.
I think we're all watching too closely.
It's summer. Melissa's hit it on the nail on the head. It's summer. And so even though this is a juicy political season, I do think people are kind of watching on the periphery, just like what's going on. And so out of the corner of their eye, they see a man who's done something that our current president hasn't done. Out of the corner of their eye, they see him in a black church hugging people, dancing. Out of the corner, they'll tune back in, I think, now, as traditionally they do.
Interesting.
And now the message matters.
See, over the weekend, I'm walking around, I'm talking to people who, you know, you see a occasionally here and there over the summer who aren't totally invested in this but are aware. A few weeks ago they were like, wow, he really blew it, he's out of it, I always knew he wasn't going to win, blah blah blah. Now this weekend people are walking up to me and they're going, wow, he pulled even, I'm so surprised. They don't like him or not like him, I mean, it's an even mix.
Yeah.
Especially, you know, when you're in New York and outside of New York, that's not a great random sample.
Yeah.
But of the people
that's
I'm talking to, they were both Republicans and Democrats, and they're all reflecting the same thing. Wow, he had no chance, now all of a sudden it's even. So what has changed in the past few weeks? I think he is I think he's been more disciplined on message. I think that he's done. He did the Louisiana thing. He did the Detroit thing. He did the Mexico thing. That he's been away from the Clintons more and more focused on here are the things that I see that are wrong that I think I could fix. And I think on the negative side, you know, for her, there's been so much about the emails and everything that that's been relentless. That when you have the New York Times coming out and saying that you've got to shutter the foundation, you have the Boston Globe, you've got to shutter the foundation, and they keep calling for it, and she keeps not doing that. Between that and the emails, people are hearing that same Clinton stuff in the background.
What can she do to soften her image, to reduce her negatives?
It's too late. I mean, it's too late.
Too late?
It's too late.
Wait a minute. You're the premier Democratic analyst in the state of New Jersey.
Wow.
You're telling me
I'm hopeful. No, it's not just New Jersey.
New Jersey's in the bag for her. We both know New Jersey well, but you're telling me it's too late?
This is what I said. This is going to be a race to the bottom.
Wow.
And
it's about the negatives.
Her people, I shouldn't speak for them. I suspect that they understand that she's not going to be, nobody's going to wake up on October 1st and say, oh my God, Hillary Clinton, I've known about her for 30 years. I suddenly love her. There is a very strong component of people who do love her very passionately. Older women of her generation love her. They think she stands for what they've always stood for, which is the shattering of the glass ceiling. So it's not that she doesn't have this very passionate core support among some people. She does. But overall, after 25 to 30 years of knowing about Hillary Clinton, you're not going to suddenly fall in love with her. And she knows that. And I assume they know that. So for them, this is why we talked about earlier, why this is such a negative race and why she's focused on Trump. She doesn't need to win and be beloved. This is not Obama in 2008.
I have a different thought.
It's that she needs to kill Donald Trump.
So what we saw when we were covering the primary season, and Sandra, I think you brought this up a couple of times, Trump gets away with stuff that other people don't get away with.
Oh, well, I think everybody's
I think she's trying to maybe play some cards from his deck. We'll see if it works for her.
Can I go back to what you started saying? You said, if you believe that the Clintons are corrupt, then she's not your cup of tea in this election. But I don't know if that makes sense when you look at what happens in the polls. Even a majority of those who say they support Hillary Clinton and will vote for
her
don't trust her.
Exactly right. They don't trust her, but they don't necessarily think she's some criminal who should be taken away in handcuffs, which if you read my Twitter feed, you do think she should be taken away in handcuffs. Yeah. That's the difference.
Well, if I read your Twitter feed, I think they want to take you away.
Well, please.
Yeah, I don't know.
Read my Twitter feed, I need 24-hour armed security. But she...
I want to
give you a hug.
Oh, see, thank you.
So
what this race is going to become, because both these candidates are loathed, is it's ultimately going to come down to competence. Yeah. It's not going to come down to likability. It's going to come down to
competence. So how do you prove that, though?
Competence.
So how do you prove that, though, I guess is the question. I want to go to Peppa Pig fan.
Oh, me too. We love Peppa Pig.
By the way, I mean, I don't want to do
Dutchess didn't know Peppa Pig.
I don't want to do like the cover of Sports Illustrated jinx here, but rock solid numbers today with people on the live chat, numbers
great,
of people watching us,
great,
which means I hope that they're hearing their voice here, because that's what we want. So right, Peppa Pig fan.
What does Peppa Pig say?
She writes a long kind of message here. She wants to talk about voter ID law. We've got the perfect person to do that. One of the ladies last week, she called us ladies, said it would cost old people too much to get a state ID to vote. You were the lady. So I should not be required to get one. But in Texas, if you are 60 years old, the cost is $6. You're telling me someone cannot afford $6?
No.
I'm Hispanic and grew up in a low-income neighborhood, and I know most old people can afford $6 or their family would pay for it. My mom and her friends have state IDs, blah, blah, blah.
Can I just clarify that real quickly? Because I think people misunderstood what I was saying. It's not that they don't have the money to get a voter ID for $6. It's that a lot of people don't have the underlying documents they need to get the voter ID. So I can't just walk into a voter.
Is that because they're here illegally?
No, it is because some of them don't have access to a birth certificate. Some of them don't because they may have been born at a time and at a place where their birth certificates are no longer available.
All right, so here's the law, whether you think this is fair or not. The law is if the purpose or the effect of the law disproportionately harms a group, then the law is unconstitutional. Mm-hmm. So if there are more old Hispanic people in Texas without the ID card, even though the law was not aimed at them, and it disproportionately affects them more than it does white people in the same age group, the law is unconstitutional.
Oh, that's
why Texas's law was thrown out. It wasn't the purpose, and it wasn't anything they said on the floor of the legislature, is that it didn't impact these various groups equally.
All right, one more trend I'm seeing on here with the last few seconds. Mrs. Chase 09, DJON, saying, if you have no memory, you're not qualified. I don't recall how to run the country, exclamation point. They're talking about Hillary Clinton not being able to remember some of the documents. And Tiffy 100 says that this person doesn't believe that Trump appeared to be genuine when he went into the church of people of color, so on and so forth. And so that is some criticism. People are saying, well, they're doing it for votes and for politics. But I think that makes, I mean, haven't we seen every politician do that, or is he different?
There's our music.
I don't know. When politicians
kiss
babies,
just like the Oscars are playing us off.
Do they love the baby?
Politicians kiss babies. Do they love the baby? That's a great question.
Judge,
all right,
thank
I just
you.
Wanted to get a quick fuse staccato in
best.
There. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye.